with pranams at the lotus feet of our Bhagavan. Dear brothers and sisters, nice to meet you this morning once again. We are trying to know the various dimensions of avatar, particularly the lessons that we can learn from his life. It is very clear to all of us that avatar has a message to convey to the humanity. And we as devotees are to emulate his example, walk along the path laid ahead of us. That is the very purpose of an incarnation or an avatar. It is in this direction we are making an in-depth study of the subject. Now, the question is this. Some say that we are away from Swami. Some say that we are close to Swami. Some say we feel Swami. Some say we do not feel Swami. Some say that we miss him a lot. We feel sorry for his absence. Some say, no, we feel him. Many miracles have been happening after he left us. So we have two sides of a coin. It's just a survey of the places known to you, and the devotees you know will certainly bring to light that many miracles are happening today all over. Somebody sent me by email a photograph where you find Swami turning backwards and moving little bit away from Samadhi. Evidently it means he got up and then moving away from that. That shot is captured in my computer. Somebody forwarded to me. And I also hear last night a Telugu pandit, scholar in Telugu language, who was the student of Sachasai Sanskrit school started in those days by name Bharadwaj. He was the first batch student of Veda Patashala in those days. He is a pandit there. He rang up last night and he tells me that he found a broken coconut in front of Swami's picture. Another day he tells me that he could find a lump of turmeric on the picture of Bhagavan. What to say this? What guts I have to say they are false. And here in one of the round blocks, I hear there is a continuous flow of vibhuti. What shall I say about it? And there is a place close to Puttaparthi by name Karnool. Karnool is quite close to this. And he tells me that in a public place, Sai Center, they find the turmeric and nectar, kumkum, vibhuti falling from Swami's pictures every day. And he also adds that there are so many neighboring villages in and around Karnool. And wherever they go, they find manifestation of Vibhuti. All doctors are observing these miracles. It is not an individual imagination. It is not a fallacy. It is not a fiction. It is not a dream. But it is a fact. Naturally, we conclude that Swami is ever present. It is only the physical body that is not available as we wish. But yet, there are many, many people who are experiencing Him more than before. I am telling you the truth. Why? Because I am also, like any one of you, miss Swami. I also feel that to stay here is meaningless without Him. I also feel like anybody. But when a thought flashes in the mind, suddenly you get a phone call from a friend. You know, one fellow gentleman, one gentleman told me, cashew nuts are falling from Swami's picture. Cashew nuts. Perhaps Baba is after variety now. Very good. Very good. They are all dependable people. And they don't get anything by bluffing. They are very genuine people, quite well known to me. So whenever our minds waver, whenever mind tends to lose its faith, whenever the mind oscillates, vacillates, we get message from some quarter, the living experience of Sai. Meaning, He will not allow you to get out of this place. And a personal note here, at a time when we wanted to go, we could not go. At a time when we are free to go, we are not going. Those days when we really wanted to go, for certain, being not able to bear some discomfort or something like that, when we want to leave, we could not because of Swami. Today you are free, come and go. You cannot. In other words, your movements are under watch, under control. Baba, operating, remote control. We are not in a sense. We may pack, yet unpack and settle down. Because remote control it is there. He'll switch anything to stop you. And it's quite interesting to be a part of the game. Actually, we'll enjoy life when we are choiceless. Choiceless. Why should you choose to be here? Why should you not choose to be here? Choiceless. Let things happen as they should. Let things happen as they're destined to happen. Yes, why not? Therefore, spirituality, defined by some of the scholars this way, choiceless awareness. Choiceless awareness is spiritual experience. And to be aware that I am choiceless in this life. While young, we feel I can exercise my choice, that things go as I like, that I can prefer and differ. That was the feeling in youth. But later, as age advances, with maturity and growing experience, everyone will understand how foolish we were then, if not wise now. We were certainly foolish then, but we are yet to be wise now. Therefore, my friends, to think of this concept, I am away from Swami, I am close to Swami. Baba, what do you say about it? Let us put him this question. Swami, how do you answer this? Are you near me or are you away from me? What do you say about it? Now Baba gives this example. Kindly follow this. As I repeatedly tell at every meeting, all these are collections from Sai literature only. Thank you, Rabbi. Thank you so much. So, well, what does Baba say about it? He gives this example. Suppose you want to go to Bangalore. What do? You board the train. You go to station and board the train en route Bangalore, right? When you are approaching Bangalore, what do you say? Bangalore has come, Bangalore has come. Then, when you are back to Puttaparthi, what do you say? Halfway, Bangalore left, Bangalore left. But it has not come and it has not left. It is there where it is. It is only you and I that have come. Only you and I that have left. But Bangalore is Bangalore. It is there only. Similarly, Bhagavan is there, eternally present. He is ever existence. It is only you and I that feel nearness, that feel distance. We go close, we go away. So it is only a question of our attitude and our feeling. He is what he is. He is what he has been. He is what he should be. Being divine, that is the thing. Okay, Swami, then what is my attitude now? What should be my attitude? To be near you, to feel your nearness, what should be my attitude? What should be my pattern of life? What should be my lifestyle? Baba gives the answer. Very simple. After all, I didn't ask you to take to some austerities, to take to certain physical exercises which are strenuous. I don't ask you to take up certain expensive tasks like conducting yajna, yaga. Baba suggests a simple method which is not strenuous, which is not expensive, for which you don't need to depend on others, and you don't need any priest, any auspicious day to begin, any auspicious moment to launch the project. After all, a simple formula. What does he say? If you follow the human values, understand you are with me and in me. You are with me and in me. If you care to follow the human values for which I have been struggling hard over decades. You may be wondering, why should Swami struggle to re-establish these human values? The reason is simple. We don't need to tell any animal behave like an animal. We don't need to tell any tree behave like a tree. Unfortunately, we have to tell a human being, be like a human being. You don't need to tell a dog, be like a dog. It will say, I'm barking and I'm fine. I'm a watchdog, fine, I'm fine. But something wrong with the man and the human being who has to be told, retold again and again that he has to behave like a human being, because we are inhuman. That's the reason why Baba has taken up a project, Education in Human Values. Education in Human Values is going on globally in a large scale. Most of the Sai institutions implemented this EHV program, Education in Human Values, because we have lost them. We only think of money value that goes up and down the bullion market. We care for inflation, deflation, price rise, devaluation, forgetting we lost our value. My value is more important than money. My value is more important than my furniture. That we have forgotten. Therefore, Baba has come to remind us to know our own value, to practice these values, and to propagate these values, to be very, very near Him and close to Him. Swami, all right, all these four values are there, five values. Values are Satya, Dharma, Shanti, Prema, Ahimsa. Everyone can successfully repeat the names of these values, okay. Is it possible to practice all the five? Some teachers of Education in Human Values, EHV program, they tell me every value has sub-value. Every sub-value has sub-sub-sub-value. They have come to 128 values, it seems. A big dhobi list. Swami, how am I to practice these values? Values, sub-values, sub-sub-sub-values. How is it possible? Then Swami gave a very straight answer. All right, forget them all. I know that you cannot practice all of them. Just have one value. That is enough. One value? Yes. What is it? Love. If you practice love, that is enough. As good as practicing 128 values, which our teachers have successfully calculated as on this day. It may be revised tomorrow, I do not know. But all values summed up come to only one value, the value of love. Further, Swami said this statement, which makes all of us feel very introspective. Self-examination. What did he say? I want the heart. I think of the heart. I see your heart. I don't listen to your words. I don't listen to your words. Further, he says, heartless words. Meaning, he doesn't mean heartfully. Heartless words are useless. On the other hand, I prefer wordless heart. Wordless heart. No, nothing to speak. Heart full of love. Therefore, my friends, Bhagavan Sri Satsai Baba gives us a clue that one value, practice of love, is adequate enough to be very, very close to his heart, to be in constant company. Swami, when it is so simple, love is so simple, but why is it I am not able to practice it? On the other hand, some people ask, how to love? Silly. Who has to teach you love? Is there any teacher who teaches love? That fellow has no love first. Love is natural. Love is divine. We are born with love. A child loves the mother. Child has not gone to any university to learn lessons on love. We love our brothers. No school taught us how to love. We love sisters. We love friends. When we look at somebody, we love immediately. Why? We do not know. No extra classes, no practical laboratory demonstrations, no test tubes or anything like that. Suppose when you look at somebody, you have got feeling of love towards him. Why? I don't know. Nobody can say. In other words, love is natural. Or you can't say, just wait, let me try to love you next month. Love doesn't wait for time. Or let me love you on the railway platform, as if you are going to hate at the airport. Silly. Love has no time. Love has no space. Love has no age either. We fall in love with aged people. Aged people, they love youngsters. So that which is beyond time, space, age, nationality, profession, qualification, avocation, anything of that sort, beyond that, that is love. Sometimes we start loving a pun there. Why? He is not of my qualification. He is not my colleague. Just I love him. Why? No explanation. If there is anything in this world, if there is anything in this world that has no explanation at all, it is love. If anyone tries to explain love, it means that fellow has no love. It cannot be explained. It is automatic, spontaneous. Then Swami, if it is so spontaneous, how is it that I am not able to love? Why? Why don't I love? If it is so natural, why? Now Swami gives a beautiful answer. Such Sai Baba is unique in his own style. We think of so many other things, forgetting the fundamental things. Baba stands for his message. The message is eternal. The message is immortal. The message is nectarine, universal, cosmic. We should concentrate on such a message for which has come down in human form. Now the question, when love is natural, why is it I am not able to love everybody, irrespective of age, nationality, gender, all concerns? I should be able to love everybody. Why? Now Baba gives us explanation. Because love is underneath, like the current of water, like the flow of water, like the natural springs of water at the bottom. Beneath the ground, there is a film of water. And that film of water beneath the ground is covered by stones, sand, gravel, silt. All this stuff has covered the film of water underneath the ground. So what shall I do? Remove all the stuff. Remove all the boulders. Remove all the stones. Remove all the sand, gravel, silt. then you will come to know the hidden, underlying, thin film of water which flows automatically. This happens as we dig a well. When you dig a well, you go on removing all the stuff above so that you will get that current flow of water beneath. Likewise, there is a current flow of water of love in the well of our heart. Our heart is a well. There is a thin film of flow of water in our hearts as in a well. But it is covered by stones of pride, boulders of ego, the sand of selfishness, and the gravel of self-interest, and the silt of jealousy, and the slush of envy. So all these things have covered the natural water underneath. Come and remove them so that you will get it. Okay, Swami, where shall I throw all this? You want me to throw all right? Where shall I throw? Who will accept? I'll tell you, I'll give some of my pride to you, some of my envy to you. I'll donate. Are you ready to accept? I'll donate in charity a part of my envy to you. Are you ready? No. So when you are to give up these qualities, who is ready to accept them? Baba gives this answer. Nobody will accept. Nobody. But I am ready to accept. Come on. Come with all your pride. Come with all your envy. Come with all your ego, jealousy, whatnot, avarice, hatred, possessiveness. Come with all those evil qualities. I will accept. Swami, you accept? How do you accept? Because it will spoil you also, so long you are so comfortable. When you start accepting these donations of hatred and collections of pride and envy, you get polluted. Why do you accept that? Why do you accept that? How is it that they don't affect you? How is it they don't affect you when you accept them? Baba gives the answer. Look here. Cat has teeth. And with that teeth, the cat can kill the rat. Right? Cat kills the rat with its biting sharp teeth. But the very same teeth of the cat will hold the kitten, the younger ones, and shift them to a safe place. The teeth won't harm the kitten, but the teeth will kill the rat. So teeth can hold and teeth can also kill. I see. Take for example, this example given by Baba. Another example, cobra, snake. It has got poison in its jaws. Poison. When cobra bites you, finish. Nobody would survive. Because of the poison there. But the same poison won't harm cobra. Manufacturer is not harmed. So the poison will not harm the cobra. But when cobra bites you, you are killed. So therefore, just as the poison of the cobra will not affect cobra, Your bad qualities cannot spoil me. Your bad qualities cannot affect me. Your bad qualities cannot bother me. Just as cobra is not affected by the poison. Oh Swami, That's why we run after him. Nobody can give such beautiful examples. We go to some places where scholars speak. You take immediate decision not to attend the next meeting. Because we will have enough of madness. They are mad, they are confused, and they will doubly confuse us. By the time we return home, it is enough if our people recognize us. Because that is the way people explain. Whereas Baba puts it in a very, very simple, excellent style. He gives another example. Sai's style of explanation. Yeah. What does he say? In a circus, where there are wild animals like tigers and lions and all wild animals are there. In their midst stands the ringleader, circus master. Those wild animals cannot do anything because that ringleader, master circus, can manage them. Whereas you and I, even behind the iron bars, even next to them, we are afraid of them. It may fall, impossible, because there is an iron cage about 20 feet, but still we are afraid to look at them. Whereas ringleader is not at all bothered. They can't harm him. Likewise, your evil qualities are like these wild animals. They will attack you. But I am the ringmaster, okay? I am the circus master. I will make them dance. They cannot affect me. Therefore, my friends, in a nutshell, what Baba wants to communicate is, surrender all your evil qualities so that that undercurrent flow of water of love will spring up like a fountain available to you. Surrender all your evil qualities such that good qualities will manifest on their own. That is the explanation Baba gives. And further Swami says, what is sadhana? People think, if you ask them what is sadhana, you ask somebody there. In Kulundhal, when there is still time for bhajan, ask anybody, what is sadhana? Don't you know? I don't know, please let me know. Get up at 3 o'clock in the morning. Oh. Till 7 you meditate. Oh. How to do that? I am doing for the last 25 years. Oh, I see. How? From 3 to 7. Good. I will immediately tell on his face, you are not meditating from 3 to 7. You are simply sleeping successfully. Because we will have good sleep at that time. Early hours. Very nicely. Nobody can. We can snore also. If you ask somebody else, how are you doing? What is your sadhana? My sadhana is prayer, constant. I live in prayer throughout the day. Oh, perhaps you have no job. You have no job. And nobody visits you. So you are undisturbed, jobless, unemployed, fit for nothing fellow. So he says, I'm a prayer. He has no idea of what prayer is. No idea. If you ask somebody, what do you do? I read Lalita Sahasranama, Vishnu Sahasranama, I read that stotra, this stotra. Ah, good. Continue to read. What is happening by reading? I read. What is there to happen? Oh, you read and you don't expect anything to happen. and you say that nothing is happening, but you say, I am reading. I don't know all this. Then I would say, I'll put a tape recorder. It will read on your behalf. Put a DVD there, correct intonation better than you. Therefore, my friends, in this dilemma, in this confusion, in this state of what and what not, what is right, what is wrong, Baba tells us what sadhana is. Surrendering bad qualities, giving up unwanted qualities, is sadhana. Not acquiring anything. You don't need to do any sadhana for truth. Truth is already there with you. You don't need to do any sadhana to acquire love. You are born with love. All the good stuff is in you. What we have to do is unload the dirty stuff. That's all. That is sadhana as Bhagavan has defined. Then there are a category of people whom we come across. They go on complaining. We have joint pains. We have pains near shoulders. We have neck pain. And we have back pain. Yes. The present pain is because of the pain you have given before to others. As the boss of the office, you were a pain to everybody. As head of the family, you are a pain to everybody. Now you understand how sweet that pain is in different joints of our body. As we walk, we can understand. Particularly people here will limp naturally because of water problem. The fluorides. There's one gentleman who came here as a visiting professor. For 1 year he was like that. He's from Harvard University and it's American style. I thought, let me give him some time. Because flight is above. It has to land someday. Let us wait. I used in the beginning, I said, how are you, sir? Fine, good. I said, okay, let us see. After 1 year, I saw him limping. I said, what's wrong, sir? Some joint pain, Anil Kumar. Then I told him, now I own you. Now I declare that you belong to this place. You are a citizen. No longer forward or forward or backward. You belong to this place from now on. Because joint pains is the first eligibility to be a citizen of this place and to get into the voters list. You don't need any PAN card or ID. Identification card, not necessary. When you limp, yes, put up a thing, man. No. Yeah. If he doesn't limp, he has to wait for green card or citizenship. You see? So, things have... Swami, in spite of all this, in spite of all these problems, yet, relatively we are good. Relatively. Just compare ourselves with those of our age. We are better than them. Yes. If we are not satisfied with the present levels of health, I cannot help. But compare ourselves with other friends of our age group. They have nothing to talk other than blood pressure, sugar, Etelal 25 mg or 100 mg. And are you having sorbitrate under the tongue or above the tongue or into the ear? And who is your family doctor?
This is the talk. Go outside. But every fellow has got a lot of money in the bank account. 25 lakhs, 50 lakhs. But they lack health. They lack mental peace. But lakhs are there. Lakhs. But you find on the face, they lack a smile. Accounts are fine, but no smile. But we, with Swami, in the company of Swami, in Prashantinilayam, with the thought of Swami, joining his bhajans, talking to the devotees, moving amongst devotees, we are relatively, comparatively better than most of the fellows outside. You can take it from me. Please believe me. This is a scientific data. Yes. This is the gift of Bhagavan to all of us. Why? How are we like this? Why are they outside are not like us? Why? They can also be happy. They can also be healthy. Why are they like that? Baba gives the answer. Three are necessary to be energetic, to be youthful. Everyone wants to be youthful. Maybe 80 years also, he wants to be youthful. Why not? Somebody told me, sir, this is the youth conference. When I was going there, somebody said, this is youth conference. Evidently he meant, not for you. Instead of saying not for you, he said, sir, this is youth conference. I said, what youth conference? Where are youth? I said, sir, there is number of youth. I said, I'm youthful. They may be youth, but I'm youthful. Why not? Therefore, one can be youthful, young, energetic, hale and healthy, smiling, with beaming laughter, happiness, dance, music, enjoy life, provided we have three. The first, patience. First requirement is patience. We don't have patience. Why? We want everybody to agree with us. We want everybody to walk along the way we walk. We want everybody to accept our thought. Impatient fellow. That's why face, as Swami calls it, a castroil face. And why do you want others to follow you follow you? Not necessary. I follow my own way. Why not? I have my own way. I have my own thought. I have my own life. Why should I follow you? Not necessary. When others don't follow you, why are you disturbed? Why are you impatient with others? That's why we at this age are unwanted stuff at our places, because we are impatient with our children and grandchildren. If there is anything wrong with the grandchild, you want to correct immediately. The grandchild belongs to computer age. They will say, shut up, Tata. Please. And if you go on advising your son, what will he say? Your times are different from our days. Meaning, shut up, in a mild way. Meaning is same. Language polished crude, that's all. Instead, all right, it is their job. It is their job, it is their life. Let them manage in the way they like. Why should I interfere? If I am little more patient, I will be more happy. If I am not patient, I give them some advice, they don't follow. They are happy that they disobeyed me. And that disobedience increases my blood pressure. They are happy. Why all that? My friends, this is the art of living. This is the art of life. to live in an art. We can really enjoy life if we are patient enough with everybody. So to be youthful, smiling, healthy, one has to be patient enough. And two, we find something wrong in everyone. He is late for darshan. Correct. Tomorrow if you are late, shall I tell you? Why are you late? We'll tell somebody, he is not along the right path. Who told you are along the right path? You give certificate for yourself or what? We find the mistakes in everybody. Really. Very good. But we don't find our own mistakes. Meaning, I can see the back of everybody. I cannot see my own back. That does not mean I have no back. I do have. But I cannot see. Similarly, we find the mistakes, weaknesses of everybody. On the other hand, we also feel happy in knowing the mistakes. Happy. Why? By pointing out a mistake in you, I think I am virtuous. By finding out a weakness in you, I think that I am grand and great. The self-glorification is the secret by pointing out mistakes of others. The dirtiest thing in this world, the ugliest thing in this world, is to point out mistakes of others, is to find fault with others. Baba puts it this way. What, supposing I say, this is a book. How can I say this is a book? I must have seen this book earlier. If you have not seen a book at all, how can you find out a book? Impossible. So you find, you recognize, you identify that which you have already seen and experienced, right? Similarly, if I say you are a fool, it means I am a double fool. Or else how can I see foolishness in you? If I say you are a proud fellow, meaning I am incarnation of pride. That's why Baba says, reflection of the inner being. Baba puts it in a polished style, because he is the latest god, you know. I always love to put it like that. Latest God, reflection of the inner being. Meaning, you are a good man. How can you say you are a good man? Unless I am good. That goodness in me reflected as goodness in you. You are bad. That bad quality in me reflected there. So reflection, everything is a reflection of the inner being. Therefore, my friends, Swami says, purity second, patience first, second purity. What is purity? Purity does not merely mean to say, I am pure. Who are you to say you are pure? To say that you are pure is impure. You cannot say that. I must say. What is purity? By not finding impurity outside is purity. By not seeing anything impure outside is purity. Thereby, good in you is brought out. Thereby, good in you blossoms. Thereby, good in you flowers, leading to fruition. You are reaching greater heights of excellence. Therefore, patience, purity. Third, I want to get a first class. with that feeling, I read and read and read. In business, I want to have some 1 lakh profit. I work and work and work tirelessly with some targets, with some aims and objectives in life. We are determined to achieve and attain. This determination is called perseverance. Perseverance is determination to attain, to achieve in a determined way. Instead of saying, Baba looked at him, I would rather say, why not he looks at me? Instead of saying he is a devotee, why not I am also be like him? So perseverance meaning a determined way, a determined effort to be what you want to be. Not to leave that attainment. Not to forget that a target at any point of time. I want to be. When Baba says, you are divine. Am I divine? Why can't I be divine? Why not? When Baba said, you are God, why should I doubt it? Am I not? If I am not, why? If I am not God, then what? At one time when I said, Swami, when you say you are God, you are God, I am not able to accept it. I am not. Then he said, all right, then you think you are a buffalo. He buffalo, he said. So it only means you are that what you think of. As you think, so you become. As you think, so you become. Yad bhavam tad bhavati. Therefore, this kind of a feeling that I am divine. So perseverance, determined approach, determined effort to be what you are already. To be that what you want to be. Therefore Baba says, one can afford to be energetic, young and active with these three, purity, patience and perseverance. And he adds one sentence, that is the secret of my life. Baba said, the secret of my success is the strict observance of these three, patience, purity, and perseverance. My friends, these things we should think often, repeatedly, and try to share with as many people as possible. It was Jesus Christ who said at one time, the whole world will know who I am by the works I have done. Jesus could make the blind see, could make the deaf hear, could make the dumb speak, could make the dead come back to life. So Jesus said, whole world will know me through my works. Through my works, through all the experiences they have had. Now Baba says this openly. See this statement. Baba said, no one has ever achieved as much I have achieved during this incarnation. During this incarnation, no one has ever achieved as much I have achieved. It is true. The stupendous projects, the worldwide organization, the massive projects, engaging thousands of people over here, inspiring lakhs of people all the world over. All that he could achieve just in one lifetime. Just as Jesus is known today, through his works, Baba will ever be known, forever and ever, through his magnificent, stupendous, unparalleled, unequaled, unbeaten, irresistible, historic projects he has undertaken. That's really marvelous. That's what he has said. I would also give you another particular feature of Baba, which we don't digest initially. You'll find Baba talking to a useless fellow, according to your calculation. You'll find Swami giving a ring to a fellow who is incorrigible. You'll find Baba calling a group of devotees for interview that they do not deserve. Because we think we are most deserving on this earth, in this planet. Why he? Why not me? So this question arises. Why God has a weakness toward these, shall I say, undesirable? Shall I say unwanted? Shall I say useless? Or shall I also add fit for nothing? So he talks to them, he grants them, why? Now Swami gives explanation. We have no time to read his literature. We have no time to go deep into his teachings. We observe and come to conclusion. There we go wrong. Every action of his, better we say, we don't understand, rather mistake, rather misunderstand. We can say, I don't know. That's a better answer. Why Swami is lenient toward this stuff? Baba gives an example. Long back, an artist came to Puttaparthi. You know, Harikatha. Harikatha is a particular form of art where there is music, dance, literature, fun. Oh yes, all in one is called that beautiful art, Harikatha. One artist came here from one of the villages. He cried and touched Swami's feet. Why are you crying? Swami, nobody is inviting me. Nobody is listening to my Harikatha, to my program. Nobody is inviting me, Swami. What shall I do? Then Swami said, don't worry, I will arrange in the college auditorium. He arranged a program for that man in the college auditorium. That man has got such a melodious voice, equal to me. As good as the sound of a railway engine. And he wants to sing and dance. Aiya. And our good God was sitting there in the auditorium, watching him, 100% focused attention, as if he never met such a standard artist. Staring at him and nodding his head. All boys were laughing, full of apashruti, out of tune. There is no tala. And his steps don't agree with the music. Music could dance independent, democratic. Voice has no synchronicity. The voice, 50 voices at a time. Abbo. But Swami, interesting watch. Boys were looking at the artist and the Swami. What is wrong with whom? Is it wrong with Swami? for listening to such a stupid program? Or is it wrong with the artist for having dared to sing like that in front of so many boys? At the end of the program, Swami gave him cash, clothes, watch, asked him to dine, go to the canteen, eat, and then go. Very difficult to digest that situation. So boys were have put a question mark. They can't ask, why do you give it? You say, it's my property, why do you cry? So we can't ask him. So they have put a question mark. What is it going on? Baba said, look here boys, I know that artist cannot sing well. I know that artist is not a class artist, I know. I also know that you don't like it. But you do not know one thing. This artist has not been eating food for the last 1 week for want of money. Nobody is inviting him. Nobody is prepared to hear music and give him some money so that that fellow can buy food. He is starving. So I see that point. Even if I am not prepared, who will care for him? Who will care to know his problem if I neglect him? Therefore, children, I don't go by the performance. I go by the performer. Performer, not performance. Therefore, my friends, that kind of insight, that kind of concern, I pay for what I get, is our commercial life. You pay for what you get. Maybe the principle of economics, but not human value. Human value lies in encouraging others, lies in bearing with them, lies in tolerating them. That's what Baba explains. And see, another feature of Swami, I'm conscious of the time, my friends, I'm conscious of it. I'll give another example. Let us take our life. Supposing I slip here, I slip, I fall. What do I say? Flooring is not properly done. Or in the morning while cleaning, some water is left. Therefore I slipped. I'll find some person or other to find fault with. I'll find some person or other to find fault. I'll say, you are responsible. You are responsible. Even my fever doesn't come down, I blame the doctor. I don't blame for not observing diet. I don't blame myself for not taking medicine properly, promptly. But I blame the doctor. What we know is, to blame others. Shift the responsibility. If you ask your son, why you got less marks this time? Teacher did not teach well. But the same teacher taught well to other students. But this fellow got less marks. Why do you get less marks now? Last night I had stomach ache. But this morning you're all right. Then why don't you write well? Meaning right from childhood, we are tempted to blame somebody, expose somebody, mention their names, condemn them, and refuse to accept the truth that I am negligent, that I am careless. We refuse that. A simple example. One day, there at Madras, Chennai now, Swami said, tell everybody there is no darshan this morning. There is no darshan this morning. There. And one gentleman came and said, no darshan this morning. No darshan. And Swami was walking behind. Pagal hai, he has no money. There is darshan, you know. That man is telling no darshan. Swami is telling, here I am, there is darshan. A very good drama, nicely enacted. Because Swami is an excellent actor. Nateshwara, actor of actors. This girl suddenly turned back, saw Swami. Swami, why did you tell me to inform everybody there is no darshan? Why are you walking behind like that? Are you let them enjoy some fun? He said. Why darshan be serious at all? Darshan also can be full of humor. Let them enjoy. And he was watching. But Swami was avoiding devotees. He was walking away from them. He didn't allow anybody to touch his feet. Laughing and laughing, walking from a long distance. And then he returned. Then this gentleman asked, Swami, you said no darshan, but you gave darshan. But you didn't walk close to them. You are always at a distance. Why? Then Swami said, look here, Rama Brahmam, the caretaker there in Vrindavan in those days. Last night, while coming down from a host, you know, had been to that house for dinner last night. While returning, what happened was, driver closed the door all of a sudden. My foot got caught up there, got crushed. My foot got crushed there. So I have put a bandage. And I could not walk. So I said, I wanted you to tell there is no darshan. But immediately I felt, so many have come to see me. So many are waiting for darshan. This is Sunday. They must have come from long distances. They should not be disappointed. Therefore I went. Now, when I am close to them, when I walk in my usual way, they may try to touch my feet. When they try to touch my feet, they'll see this bandage. They'll start crying. And when they touch the feet, Pada Namaskar, it will further swell, further complication, more pain. Why all that? So I just avoided. This is Satya Sai Baba. This is Satya Sai Baba. The one who knows to contain, swallow, all the suffering and never tell anybody, never blame anybody. Then Ram Brahma Swami, who is the driver? Who is the driver? Useless fellow, why did? Shut up. I don't know the driver at all. I have not seen him. In fact, he is a personal driver. Swami doesn't want the driver to be blamed. Swami doesn't want the driver to be beaten up by these devotees out of high range of devotion. See, covering these people, safeguarding these people, bearing all the pain to himself. Why is the message of Bhagavan Sri Satya Sai Baba. May Baba bless you, may Baba be with you forever and evermore.
Samasta loka sukhino bhavantu, samasta loka sukhino bhavantu, samasta loka sukhino bhavantu. Shanti, shanti.
Jai bolo Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba ji ki.
Jai.